Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for joining us today. I wanted to talk today about profiting in volatile, non-trending markets. Here's a snapshot of the S&P over the last couple months. And, you know, the U.S. stock market is back and is back in its obnoxious mode where we have a lot of price volatility, but no trend. And, you know, the S&P has been essentially flat over the last several months with a lot of volatility. And you can see it, the market pretty much went straight up and then straight down. So the question is, how do you profit in these kind of markets? And, you know, if you take a directional trade in this kind of market, it's really tough to profit whether you take a long trade or a short trade. So when the price volatility is like this, so I think the best way to profit in these kind of markets is with spread trades. And I've been able to profit in this type of market using a spread trade. And what I like to do is I like to buy stocks or ETFs that are performing well despite Europe and the slow-growing U.S. economy, and then sell call options against those stocks on weaker indexes or sectors. And this is essentially a spread strategy, and you're long stocks that are performing well, and you're short markets that are very weak, like Brazil and China and energy and commodities. So this is essentially a spread strategy where you're long stock and short call options. And the other thing I've been doing is when you're short a call option and the underlying stock or ETF goes down in price, you can buy that back and sell another call option. And so in the course of a week, you can sell two call options and two premiums. And I've been doing that a lot lately with these weaker sectors. I'm short Brazil calls, China, energy, and Europe. And you know, they've been declining in price, so I've been buying these calls back and selling another premium. And this week, I even sold three premiums. So I sold three option premiums in 1 week from buying back the short calls once they decline in price. And I'll show you examples of that. So with the weekly options, the beauty of the weekly options is you get to sell this premium 52 times a year, which can lead to 100% cash-on-cash return regardless of where the price movement of the underlying stock goes, and I'll show you examples of that. So in addition to profiting from your long stock on your short calls, you also get a chance with weekly options to get 100% cash on cash return, which is a pretty good situation in this type of market. And then we also trade option spreads, which can profit in any type of market.
Chuck, a real quick question for you. With your experience in trading the weekly options, do you forecast more and more companies trading weekly options?
Yes, that's a great question, Tom. Almost every week, there are new companies trading weekly options, and the list is growing. I believe I saw 138 last time I looked, but that's growing every week, and which is great news for us, because the more companies they have weekly options trading, the more opportunities we have to initiate covered calls with those companies. Now, with this spread strategy that I'm talking about today, where you buy the strong performing stocks and sell the week ETFs, you can buy any stock for this strategy, even if they don't trade weekly calls with that stock. And I'm going to show you an example of TJX. That's a company I've owned that's performing very well, but they don't sell or they don't trade options for TJX. So, but I can utilize that stock in this spread strategy that we're going to talk about today. And so basically we want to buy stocks and ETFs that are performing well despite Europe and the slow-growing U.S. economy. And then again, we sell weekly call options on weaker sectors against these what I call super portfolio stocks. So this spread strategy, that allows you to profit from the best performing stocks and at the same time profit from selling weekly calls against weak sectors. And I'll show you an example of that with TJX here. So this is a great strategy for this type of market where you can profit on both sides of the spread trade. And one of the differences with this spread trade is your upside potential is not capped. Now, when you trade a covered call, that covered call places a limit on the profit potential of the trade, but the spread strategy does not cap your upside potential if a stock moves up in price. For example, I have a 37% profit on super portfolio stock TJX. Now, at the same time, I've been profiting from selling option premium on the EFA index, which is the Europe, Far East, Asia indexed. And I've also been selling call options against the China FXI and energy ETFs. So I've been able to profit on these super portfolio stocks and at the same time profit from selling option premium on these weak sectors. So this is a great strategy for this type of market. And again, when you sell the ETF option premium against the stock, it doesn't cap your upside potential. And I've been trading these super portfolio spreads for about 6 months, and it's working well in the current market environment. And some of the common characteristics of these super portfolio stocks are that they're in a confirmed price uptrend. We use our trade selection process to select these stocks, and I like to focus on the ones that have little or no correlation to European economies and debt, and they're not dependent on the price of oil or commodities, because we've had a worldwide collapse in oil and commodity prices due to the weak economies. And so you don't want to buy stocks that are dependent on the price of oil or commodities going up, because that's been a bad bet. And as a matter of fact, I've been short that side of the market by selling these ETF calls against my super portfolio stocks. And these super portfolio stocks, they have strong growth rates in a slow growing U.S. economy, and they're in leading industry. So this is the trade selection criteria I use to come up with these super portfolio stocks. Here's an example of one for TJX, and that's the retailer. It's been doing well in this current environment. Just reported good earnings, and this is the typical super portfolio stock. It's doing well despite the slow U.S. economy and overseas economies, especially in Europe, that are starting to go into a recession. So the first step of course, in our selection process is we want to see what the price trend is, and we use the our trend following indicator, the 50-day EMA, in relation to the 100-day EMA. And you can see in this price graph, the 50-day EMA is this blue line, and the 100-day EMA is the red line. The blue 50-day EMA is above the 100-day, so TJX is in a price uptrend. And we also use the on-balance volume indicator, which is in this lower part of the chart here, to confirm this price uptrend. And what we like to see on the on-balance volume indicator is the line sloping up. If that line is sloping up, that means the volume can help sustain this price uptrend, and it confirms the price uptrend. So we use the on-balance volume as a confirming indicator, and we also like to look at stocks that are making new 52-week highs, and we can see that TJX has been making a series of new 52-week highs. So stocks that are making new 52-week highs, of course, are the best stocks out there, and we like to focus on those types of stocks. And then, so TJX is one of the super portfolio stocks. It's in a confirmed price uptrend, has little correlation to the European debt crisis. It's not dependent on the price of oil or commodities. And TJX has strong equity and retained earnings growth rates despite the slow-growing U.S. economy. And it's in a TJX is in a leading industry, retail. So this is the criteria I use to select these super portfolio stocks. And I took this snapshot, I believe, yesterday or the day before, and I had a $61,000 open trade profit for my TJX stock. Now, what I did and what I've been doing is I've been selling the EWZ, which is the Brazil ETF. I've been selling call options against this Brazil ETF and selling these call options against my TJX stock position. And we can see that the Brazil index, here's a price chart here, it's been very weak. The 50-day EMA crossed below the 100-day EMA, so it's in a price downtrend. You can see the on-balance volume line is sloping down, which we like to see if we're going to be short a market, and it's making a new 52-week low. So the Brazil index, obviously in a price downtrend. So these are the type of markets that we want to be short by selling call options against our super portfolio stocks. Here's an example of calls I sold over the past week for the Brazil index. I sold 13 of the May 19th calls, 57 strikes at 105, and I sold 8 of the 57 strikes at 72. So by selling these 13 options and then a day later selling 8 options, I collected a total of $1,909 after commission. And of course, this cash goes right into my brokerage account immediately as soon as I sell these call options. So I had $1,909 of cash credited to my brokerage account as soon as I sold these calls. And so I sold a total of 19.41 points of option premium with the sale of the 21 Brazil index calls. And again, this resulted in $1,909 in cash after commission being credited to my brokerage account. So this cash credit, of course, reduces the cost basis of my TJX stock and reduces the overall risk of the trade. And again, with these weekly options, you get to sell 52 of these options every year. So this allows me to compound my returns very quickly. And just some basic with options. Options consist of time value and intrinsic value. And at-the-money or out-of-the-money calls consist of only time value. And at option expiration, options lose all of their time value. So if you're short a call option, the time value of that option becomes profit at expiration because the time value goes to zero and you're short that call regardless of the price movement of the underlying stock. So that's the basic concept behind selling these at-the-money call options. They're all time value. That time value decays to zero 1 week later, and that becomes profit regardless of the price movement of the underlying stock. So that's the basic concept behind selling these at-the-money call options. So EWZ, the Brazil index, was trading at 56.95, and I sold 13 of the 57 strike calls at 105. So if the ETF is trading at 56.95 and I sell the 57 strike call, that would be considered an at-the-money call, and that would consist of only time value. So again, that time value equals profit at option expiration. So selling those 13 57 strike weekly calls at 105 resulted in $1,347 of time value profit 1 week later, regardless of where EWZ is trading. So if I project that out, and I sold a similar call each week over the next 52 weeks, I would sell approximately the 1,347 times 52 weeks. I'd sell approximately $70,000 in potential time value profit. In other words, if I sell a similar premium each week against that Brazil index, I would collect approximately $70,000. Now, when I sold those 13 57 strike calls, that covered about $74,000 of TJX stock. So in other words, 57 strike calls, that's $5,700 worth of that ETF times 13. So that will cover approximately $74,000 worth of stock. Now, of course, I don't have the EWZ stock. I have the TJX stock. So selling those 13 calls covered about $74,000 of the TJX stock. So if we take this $70,000 in potential time value profit over that 52 weeks and divide it by the amount of stock that it covers, we're going to get approximately a 94% cash on cash yearly return from selling those call options if you do that 52 weeks over the course of a year. So that's an actual cash on cash return. So even if TJX stock declines 20%, I still have the potential to realize a great return just from selling those weekly calls week in and week out. So that trade has the potential of returning 94% over the course of the year, and that does not include the profit potential for TJX stock. Now, I normally roll over these weekly options. So if I collect over the course of a year, if I collect $70,000 in time value profit from selling those calls, I reinvest that each week, and that allows me to purchase more stock and sell more call options, and that can increase this 94% return potential. In other words, you're compounding your returns each week as you receive this premium. So that can really add up over the course of a year, and it allows you to compound your returns. And now what I did was I sold the 13 Brazil 57 strike calls on May 10th. Then May 11th, I sold another 8 calls, same strike, 57 strike. Now the Brazil index went down in price. So 3 days later, I bought these 21 calls back, and I bought them back at 13 cents. And so that cost me about $293 to buy these calls back, because, you know, they went from 105 to 13 cents. So they have very little downside protection, very little premium left. So what I did is I bought the calls back, and then I went ahead and sold some more calls on the same day, on the 14th, and I received another $1,261 in premium. So sold the calls on the 10th and 11th, bought them back on the 14th, sold more calls on the 14th. So I was able to double dip, you know, and get more than two premiums inside of a 1 week period. And then the Brazil index became really weak, and I bought back those calls a second time, paid $296 to buy these back, and then I went ahead and sold some more calls, and collected another $1,130 in premium. So over the past week, because this index has been so weak, I actually triple dipped. In other words, I sold the calls, bought them back, sold the calls again, bought them back again, sold the calls again. So I got three premiums in 1 week, and for a total of about $4,000 in premium from selling these calls over the course of a 1 week period.
Chuck, a question regarding that, regarding the premium you're bringing in. Earlier you had mentioned that you roll over it and you love the compounding effect. Do you take that total of $4,000 and lower your cost basis on the EWZ by purchasing more than to do more buy rights against it?
Yes. Yeah. What I do, Tom, is each week I'll take the profits and the cash I receive in premium, and I'll purchase more stock, and then, of course, sell more call options. So, yeah, I like to compound that every week. Okay, and let's look at another super portfolio stock. This is for American Capital. This is a real estate investment trust that invests in U.S. government agency mortgages. So, They borrow money at a very low rate, and then invest it in the U.S. government agency mortgages. So American Capital, we can see from the from this price chart, been in a price uptrend. The 50-day EMA is above the 100-day EMA. Unbalanced volume line is sloping up, confirming the price uptrend, and you can see that American Capital's been making a series of new 52-week highs. So American Capital's in a confirmed uptrend, and this stock has no correlation to Europe or the debt crisis. American capital is not dependent on the price of oil or commodities. And it's had a very strong equity growth rate in a slow-growing U.S. economy. And it's in a leading industry, the mortgage real estate investment trust. So this qualifies as a super portfolio stock. And as of a day or two ago, I had $38,000 in open trade profits for my American Capital stock. And the nice thing about this stock is it pays a 16% dividend. So that's a great floor to have under a stock in a market like this. If it's paying a 16% dividend, that's really a great stock to have in this type of environment, because that 16% provides a lot of protection. What I did is I sold the China ETF calls against my American Capital stock, and you can see the China ETF is in a confirmed price downtrend with the 50-day EMA below the 100-day EMA. It's been making, it just made a new 52-week low, and we can see that the on-balance volume line is sloping down, confirming the price downtrend. So I sold the China ETF calls against my American Capital stock. And I followed a similar pattern I did with the Brazil. In other words, I sold calls on the 10th and 11th. I bought them back on the 14th, sold some more calls on the 14th, bought them back on the 16th, and then sold some more calls on the 16th. So I actually collected three premiums for the China ETF, a total of $5,600 in time premiums over the past week. And FXI shares were trading at $34.96. So I sold 12 of the 35 strike calls at 75 cents. So again, that was an at-the-money call, consists of only time value, which becomes profit at weekly expiration. So sold 12 of these 35 calls at 75 cents, and I collected $882 after commission in time value premium. And we can see if I sold a similar premium each week, I'd collect $882 times 52 weeks. So I'd collect about $45,000 in premium over the course of a year. And those 12 35 strike calls cover about $42,000 of American Capital stock. So you're collecting $45,000 in premium, and that covers $42,000 in stock. So you could get up to a 109% cash-on-cash yearly return by selling that time premium. Again, even if the American Capital stock declines in price, you know, collecting this 109% cash-on-cash would still result in a good return. So again, because you're selling weekly calls and you get to do it 52 times a year, you're going to collect a lot of cash on cash income from the sale of that option every week. And now if you have a smaller account, you could invest $3,500 in one or two of the super portfolio stocks, and then sell the China ETF 35 strike call. In other words, if you sell one of the 35 strike calls, that covers about $3,500 in stock. So you could buy one or two of the super, or even three of the super portfolio stocks to create this spread in a smaller account. One thing I did want to mention about these spreads is you do need margin in your account to sell these ETF calls, because it's not a covered call because you don't own the underlying stock. So you do need a margin account to sell these calls against your super portfolio stock.
And just for a notation on that, Chuck, for those of you that are unfamiliar with that, if you're a trade monster, we have a requirement of $10,000 in cash to sell naked options. So just a heads up on that.
Okay. Thanks for pointing that out, Tom. Okay, and I took a snapshot yesterday of my transaction history in one of my accounts, and this totals the weekly calls I sold over the past week. And so I collected over $28,000 in premium over the past week. And of course, part of that was the result of buying back calls and selling premium twice or even three times in one week. So that's my premium sale this week is a little higher than average. But let's say I average maybe $20,000 a week selling these calls. You know, over the course of a year, that's over $1 million. So I have the potential of collecting over $1 million in premium over the next year if I was able to average maybe $20,000 a week in selling this option premium. So that just shows you how powerful this strategy is. Now, what I did this week is I just took some snapshots of the ETFs that I sell call options against, and then I, at the same time, I took a snapshot of the super portfolio stock. So this was yesterday. The indexes were down on average about 0.5%, and for the year they're down about 1.7%. And at the same time, I took a snapshot of the super portfolio stocks. They were up 0.5% yesterday and up about 28% for the year. Took another snapshot on Tuesday. The super portfolio stocks were up 1.4%. And at the same time, the indexes were about flat. They were up 0.12%. So you can see that the on a relative basis, these super portfolio stocks have been outperforming these indexes that were short. And so that allows you to profit in just about any type of market. If you can get stocks that are outperforming these weak indexes, you can take advantage of that with these spreads. And one thing I like to do is when I'm closing out a weekly option, I'll use a spread order to close out the option that's expiring and to sell to open the new option that expires in a week. And by using spreads, it allows me to reduce the transaction cost both on the commission and the bid-ask spread. And when you roll over, it allows you again. It allows you to compound your returns because you can purchase more stock and sell more call options each week as you collect these premiums. And here's an example of a rollover order for Home Depot. And I was buying to close 10 of the February 24th. 47 calls, selling to open 10 of the March 2nd, 47 calls. So I used a spread order to close out the expiring options and then sell to open the new options. Here's another example of a spread order. This is for Apple. They trade weekly options in Apple. So bought to close the February 24th, 505 strike call. Sold to open the March 2nd, 525 strike call. So this is an example of the rollover. And here's one more for the emerging market index fund and the NASDAQ QQQ. And I wanted to point out the difference between the premium you receive for a weekly call option versus a monthly call option. And here's an example with Apple trading at 585. The at-the-money call would be the 585 strike. So you can see there's, with this weekly 585 call, there's 7 days to expiration. And that was selling at the time at 1405. The bid was 1405. So if you sold this call at the market, you'd receive 1405 time premium. And that's over a seven-day period. Now, the monthly call that expired in 36 days was selling at 2830. So if you sell the monthly call, you'd get 2830 points of time premium because it's an at-the-money call. But over that 36 days, you get to sell five of these weekly calls of 1405, which would be about 70.25 points of premium. So you can see with these weeklies, you get 70 points of premium versus over the same time period getting 28 points of premium for the monthly. Here's another example. This is for American International Group. And this weekly call, there was 4 days to expiration when I took this snapshot, and you get 71 cents of time premium. The stock was trading at 34.46. So for the 35 call, you get 71 cents of time premium over a four-day period. And over this 110-day premium, when the August calls expire, that's you get to sell 16 of the weekly options over this 110-day period. So by selling the 16 weeklies, you get 11.3 points of premium versus 2.39 points of premium for this 3 month call or 3.5 month call that expires in August. So that just shows you there's a big difference in selling these weekly premiums versus the monthly. Here's another example for MasterCard. The stock was trading at 457. So the at the money would be the 460. And you're going to get to sell that at 1190. And if you got a similar premium over 12 weeks, you'd get 142 points of time premium versus 23 if you sell the July at-the-money call. So big difference in the premiums over the same time period if you're selling weeklies versus monthlies. Here's a recent snapshot of my weekly covered call strategy. I had at the time I took the snapshot $332,000 in actual profits, 36% return in these two accounts. So and here's a snapshot. This is from March of 2011 when I was selling weeklies, and at the time, this account had a $323,000 profit and an average return of 54%. And I was able to get this kind of return by rolling over these weeklies every week and compounding my returns. So so the average return when I took the snapshot was 54%. And here's a snapshot of my covered call portfolio in 2009. And this was actually my trading contest account. And they weren't trading the weekly options back then, but I was trading the monthlies. And that year, 2009, I had a 122% return for that year, and of course that was audited because this was in the contest and I won the contest. So these are audited returns. Trading covered calls, 2009, I had 122% return, and again that was due to the compounding. In other words, I was able to roll over the options, compound my returns, buy more stock, and sell more call options. So that shows you, even with monthly options, that the compounding really can make a difference. Now, what I did was, just to show you how powerful the selling the weekly calls and generating income, what I did is I compared the amount of money it would take to generate $50,000 of yearly income. And what I did was I took the bank rate, the one-year CD national average was 0.34%, and the five-year was 1.14%. So let's say you wanted to generate $50,000 of yearly income. So you invest your money evenly between the one-year and the five-year CDs. To generate $50,000 of yearly income, it would take over $6.7 million to generate $50,000 of yearly income. And I like to contrast that with the covered calls. And we saw where the covered calls produced a 122% return in my contest account in 2009, 54% in 2011, and then just recently this year, 36%. So let's assume that you could achieve a 33.3% yearly return from selling these weekly options, which is, I think, is a realistic return. It would only require $150,000 investment to generate $50,000 of yearly income. So obviously $150,000 compared to $6.7 million, and that just shows you the disparity between fixed income investments today versus selling these weekly call options. And if you were able to get a 50% yearly return, then of course it would require a $100,000 account to generate $50,000 of yearly income. So that concludes my presentation for today, and I'd be glad to take any questions.
One question that keeps coming up, Chuck, is do you roll out or let the stock be taken away when it goes against you?
Now, are you were talking about a covered call, Tom?
Correct, on the weeklies.
Okay, on the weeklies. And you're talking about if the stock goes up in price, you could be called out.
Is it your preference, depending on the timing, obviously, but is it your preference to buy back that option, roll out another one so you retain the stock? Or are you okay by letting the stock get exercised and just locking in your profits that way?
Yeah, normally, if, Tom, to answer your question, if the stock still meets my criteria, my selection criteria, then I'll simply roll out of it before it gets called out. Now, whenever you're short a call, there's always the possibility that you'll be called out on your stock. Now, that has not happened to me yet with these weeklies, but it's certainly possible. But I normally roll out of them on Thursday. The weeklies start trading on Thursday, so I roll out of them either on Thursday or Friday, and I have not been called yet on any of my weekly positions, even though the underlying stock may have been up substantially. So if you want to avoid being called out, of course, you can close out that short call, but there's always a possibility that you'll be called on your stock whenever you're short a stock.
That answers the question perfectly. I know there's a lot of questions out there. We have a very short webinar. For those of you that want to contact Chuck, his number's up there, as well as the support staff. They can address a lot of the questions regarding his strategy.